Okay. So let's start by recapping what we did last time. So today I'm going to start telling you about containers for hypergraphs. Last time we had a warm-up by doing containers for graphs.
Is it possible to reduce the possible header zero Weckl?
Is that better? Sim, está ótimo. Está. Não, talvez um pouco menos. Ok. Acho que valeu. Obrigado. So, what do we do? We have a graph. We look at the collection of independent sets of the graph. Let's say the ones of size m, doesn't hurt us. And let's say it has average degree d. And what we did was we constructed these two functions, which are a little weird. Let me draw a picture of them. So this is our graph. This is our independent set. We constructed a small set G of I that's contained in I and has size at most a constant times n over d. Okay. Such that there's a set F of G of I which contains I. Well, okay, so I'm a little bit vague about whether G of I is contained in F or not. Doesn't really matter. So it's F of G of I. Okay. And moreover, this F is not in some family curly F, where F, so I didn't state it quite like this last time, but this is what we actually used. F was basically any family of graphs such that every graph has a lot of edges. Okay, so you could think of F as just being all the graphs which satisfy this property, all of the. Do I mean this? Sorry. I don't mean that at all. So it's only a vertex set. So the number of edges inside each vertex set is big. Okay. So what we know about this guy is he contains few edges. Well, actually, that's not exactly what we know about, but you should think of it as that. So few edges of G. So I is independent, so there's no edges. We're going to find a slightly larger set, which contains it, with only a few edges. And the key thing is, this set doesn't depend on I, it only depends on G of I. Right? So to know what this orange set is, you don't have to know the whole of I, you just have to know this tiny, tiny set G of I. Okay? That means there aren't too many of them. So a consequence is that we can count the independent sets in, if we know something about this family F, we can count the independent sets in I. So how many independent sets are there? The size of IGM. The number of independent sets of size m is at most what? Well, given an element of this set, we can construct a g of I. So it's the sum over s in s of the family of I such that G of I equals S. Okay? Just saying that for each I, there exists a G of I in S. Okay. So that's, I didn't do anything. But the point is, all of these things are contained in F of G of I. So this is at most the sum of S and S of the size of F of S, choose F. Right? The number of independent sets, so I, such as G of I equals S, is at most size of F of S, choose M. Daniel promised to ask questions, which means the fact he's not asking means this is clear.
No, it's unclear.
Okay. You're not supposed to think about it. Well, you are supposed to think about it. You're supposed to ask quickly. So which line are you worried about? Is the first line okay? They can.
And then couldn't you have used disjoint independent sets with all maps to just one guy?
They might all map the same guy, that's fine. This will be true anyway.
Yeah. But then say that there are only three independent sets, they all map to one guy.
Yeah.
And then the upper bound would say one, but there will be three independent sets.
No, we'll say three, because there's three independent sets such that G of I is S. So pick the S that they all go to. And it would be the sum over that S of three. Yeah, yeah. So we're just partitioning the curly I according to G of I. Okay, this is just a partition. And now this follows from this fact that I is contained in GI union F of G of I. Yeah, so actually we can do even better. The first line is an equality, thank you. Yeah, second line is not, yeah. Right, yeah, the first line is just an identity. It's just, we're just breaking it up into pieces. The second line is saying how many independent sets of size, how many sets of size M are there inside F of S? Well, that many. Why is this M minus S? Because we've already said S is contained in I. Right? So we have to pick M minus S further elements from F of S. Okay. So if we have a bound on the size of F of S, one more thing. Yeah, if we have a bound on the size of F of S, then we can take that bound and just sum, we have to count the number of things in S. So this is at most, well, the size of S times the maximum size of F of S choose, as you say, choose M. Maybe I'm assuming M is not almost as big as this. Okay. Right, so this is also trivial. As long as M isn't so big that we can't throw away this M minus S, but okay. In practice it won't be. In practice we're thinking of M as being much smaller than F of S. So think N over D is much, much smaller than M, which is much, much smaller than I drew this as being only slightly bigger, and that's not true. f of s is much, much bigger than I in the picture I'm thinking of. Sorry, so let me redraw my picture to make that a bit more obvious. Yeah. The important thing for us is that it's significantly smaller than g. Sorry? Yeah, when m is smaller, yeah. And so just one final thing, how big is S? Well, every element of S is sized roughly n over d. So it's just at most n choose big O n over d. Maybe I'll put a constant here, large constant, times this. And if m is much bigger than n over d, as long as f of s is not too small, this term dominates this one. Right? So we're getting a bound, which is basically the size of f of s that we're getting choose m, which in many cases is not too far from reality. Okay? So if we can choose our family F cleverly. So the key thing is choosing a family F and proving it has this property so that you get the bound that you want here. Okay. And so we're going to want. So we're going to construct these things using an algorithm. So I did this for graphs last time. I'm going to do it maybe for three uniform hypergraphs this time. And so you'll see what the algorithm is. So that's really that's the heart of this technique. But in order to make the technique work, we're going to also need as a basic building block a theorem about F. So I'm going to call these supersaturation theorems. So I was going to say something like A is in F implies number of edges in, now H is going to be a hypergraph, so H takes place of A of G. So when F, this is a supersaturation theorem for F, it says if you're in F, then you contain a positive fraction of all of the edges of your hypergraph. Okay. And I don't know if I said this when you were last here as well. Let me remind. So we should think of that we're going to apply this, we're going to prove this for not an arbitrary hypergraph H, but a big family of hypergraphs. But what the applications we're thinking about are either the vertex set of H is 1 up to n, and the edge set of H is the set of k-term arithmetic progressions. Right, so every time you have an arithmetic progression of length k, that's an edge of size k in your k-uniform hypergraph. And the second case we're going to think of is v of h is the edge set of the complete graph on n vertices, and the edge set of h is copies of some graph h. So I'm wondering why Mauricio and Alan haven't shown up, because, well, I'm half doing this for them, anyway.
So, what do you mean here, copies of H? Because does that
So the edges, right? Yeah, so think of, so e.g., h is a triangle, then it's a three uniform hypergraph, which is all triples of edges that form triangles. Right, so your vertex set is a set of edges. So if you pick three edges that form a triangle, that's an edge of your hypergraph. If you pick three edges of your graph which don't form a triangle, then they're not. We're not doing induced at the moment. So yeah, E of H equals the collection of triples E, F, G of edges of the complete graph such that E, F, and G form a triangle. If H is C4, then E of H is the collection of E1, E2, E3, E4, such that they form a four cycle. We don't say anything about the other pair of edges, right? Just it's all collections of four edges which are in this aligned correctly. Because we want the sets to be small. Yeah, if you're in F, you're big. If you're not in F, you're small.
Yeah, the idea is if you're in F, then you can reduce it.
Yep. Okay. Okay. Okay, so these are the hypergraphs we're going to apply things to. But we're going to, in order to prove these results, we're going to use a sort of induction on the number of edges, or so induction on K. If you think of K, H as having K edges, and these are arithmetic progressions of length K, so we have a K uniform hypergraph. So we're going to need a more general statement to make it work. Okay, so let's try and state the result that we're going to prove today. Maybe we'll start over here. Yeah, can someone go and get them? It's a bit ridiculous that they're not here, given they're right outside. If they want to discuss it, they can discuss it in the back row and listen at the same time. Yeah, thanks, y'all. Right. Right, so we're going to prove the following result. The following theorem, which was first proved by, so I'm going to do the three uniform case. So this is a result of Koyokawa, Wuchak, and Riddle from the mid-90s. Actually, sorry, no. It's basically proved by Franklin Riddle, actually. Yeah. So Franklin Riddle in the 80s. It says the following, that if P, let's say, for every delta, there exists C such that if P is bigger than C over root N, and A called NP, so this is a P random subset of 1 up to N, we take 1 to n, we keep each element with probability p all independently. Then, with high probability, as n tends to infinity, and in fact, our bounds will be exponential in p times n, the maximum size of B, such that B is a subset of A and is KAP free, is little o P times N. I'd say at most delta times P times N. In other words, every subset of A of positive density contains a three-term arithmetic progression. I'm just doing three. Yeah, sorry. The threshold is different for a k-term. Okay. So when p is 1, this is Semiradi's theorem. Ah, no, sorry. It's not Franklin Rödl. This is Koikawa, Wujak, and Rödl in the 90s. My bad. Sorry. Yeah. Okay. So when p equals 1, this says every set of integers of positive density contains a three-term arithmetic progression, which is Roth's theorem. It's three-term, because I'm ready for k equals 3. Is that okay? It's the size of the set, not the number of APs. P cubed n squared is the number of APs. They're saying this is a positive fraction of the set A. I mean, the 1 over root n is the point at which your bound P cubed n squared equals Pn. So at the threshold are the same. But when P gets bigger, your bound can't possibly hold because it's bigger than A, right? Or it's trivial because it's bigger than A. Oh, no, it's e to the minus pn. Pn, not p cubed n squared. Pn. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So this is going to follow from a counting result using Markov. It's the theorem of So Balog, myself, and Samotti, and Saxon Thomason, which will probably appear this year, which says that, so for every delta, there exists C, such that if M is bigger than C root n, then there are at most delta to the m n choose m 3 ap free m subsets of 1 up to n. So before proving this theorem, let me show how it implies this theorem, which is very easy. You didn't find them. They vanished. Okay. Right. So, let me call these theorem 1 and theorem 2. So, theorem 2 implies theorem 1. So, it's just Markov. So, what do we say? Well, Markov plus Chernoff, probably. So the probability that there exists B and A, B is 3AP3, size of B equals M. By Markov, that's at most the expected number of B in A, 3AP3, B equals M, which by theorem 2, this is Markov, this is theorem 2, is at most, well, the number of choices times P to the M. Right. For each 3AP, 3M subset, the probability it's in A is P to the M. OK? Yeah. And P, so what do we do? This is at most. Delta P E N over M to the power M. Ah, so I got to choose M, right? So M equal to we're given P. We want to be able to apply the theorem. So M should be basically P times. Yes. Yeah, so what is this?
So what you're doing in inequality is just taking...
I'm taking all the sets B, which have size M, and are 3AP3. I'm looking at the probability they're contained in A. This is the only random event here, right, in this statement. This is deterministic, this is deterministic, this is random. So it's the sum over all sets of size M, which are 3AP3, of the probability of this. Yeah. Right. So what do we want to pick M to be? We want to make sure this is small, right? So we need to pick M to be bigger than, let's say, well, let's just put it equal to, why not, E squared delta PN. Right? And this is bigger than this C times root N, as long as this P is bigger than some much bigger C divided by root N. Right? So this doesn't give the same constant. But the difference is just a factor of delta. It gives basically the same constant. Okay? If you pick it to be equal to this, this is equal to e to the minus m, which is e to the minus delta pn, like I promised. Right. It's okay. Everyone happy? Happy? Sort of. Okay, so nothing happened, just Markov. Okay. Right. So, sorry, I just rubbed out the first thing. If we can prove a result, so this result was a bound on the independent sets in some graph. If instead we can get a bound on the number of independent sets in this hypergraph, what is an independent set in this hypergraph with k equal 3? It's exactly a 3AP-free subset of size m. Right? So if H is the hypergraph which encodes three APs, then an independent set of size m is exactly the thing we're trying to count. Right? So we are just trying to count this set in order to prove theorem 2. Happy? Good. Right. OK. So after that fairly long introduction, let's try and figure out how to prove a container theorem for three uniform hypergraphs. So. P is bigger. Oh, sorry, so you're claiming that so if I'd picked M to be bigger, I would have got a stronger bound, which is true, isn't it? Yeah, so the bound is really this. And no, the way to maximize, sorry, no, you take, the bigger you take M, the smaller this is. Ah, but you want to take it to be this, right? If you're going to deduce the theorem. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so we deduce the theorem with an E squared in front, right? Yeah, so the probability does go down because if you make this, but sort of. Right. So what do we do when we're dealing with graphs? What we did was, so recall we want to construct a function g that maps the independent sets to some set S. These are small sets. And the function f, which maps S to some f complement, where being in f allows you to deduce that you have many edges of your hypergraph. OK. Right, so we want some kind of supersaturation theorem, and yeah, so I should decide whether to do this in general or specifically first. So let me recall what happened for graphs first. That's better. What we did was we basically ordered the vertices in decreasing order of their degrees. And we went along from the left until we found an element of I. And we called this V1. And we put V1 in S. Okay, in G of I. So. And then once you've put V1 into S, what do you know? You know you can throw away all the vertices here, because you already checked them and they're not in I. So I mean, throw away, I mean, which vertices do you know are not in your independent set? Okay. So we're given an independent set, and we're trying to find a small set which encodes it. So we look from the left, we say none of these elements are in I, but this one is. And moreover, because it's an independent set, if you look at all its neighbors, they're also not in I, right? Because V1 is in I. Okay, so V1 is a member of S, and the red vertices are thrown out of, let's call it A. A is the remaining vertices, the active vertices. And A is going to be our candidate for F of S. Sorry? This is just the graph version now. Yeah, sorry. Okay. And what we did, what we observed was that whichever vertex we take, either this set here has size at least epsilon n over d, or the degree of V is at least epsilon n over d. Remember, d was the average degree. So if we pick a very early vertex, it'll have the average degree at least. What am I talking about? Sorry, d. Epsilon times d. Epsilon times d. Right. D is the average degree. So if we pick an early vertex, it'll have high degree. If it doesn't have high degree, we must have skipped a decent number of vertices. So we get to throw out epsilon d vertices every time, which means after 1 over epsilon times n over d steps, we'll have got down to nothing. Well, okay, but the process must have stopped at some point. And when does it stop? It stops when we reach a set A, which is not in F. Okay, so we keep selecting vertices while our set A is in F, because then we know that there are many edges left over. If there are many edges, then this holds. Right? So this epsilon is the same as this one, except maybe it was divided by 2 or something. Okay. So while we have many edges left in our set, we can perform another step of the algorithm and throw out a lot of stuff. Once we don't have a lot of edges, we know we're not in F, and then we're done. Then we can stop. Right? Okay. So how are we going to do this with a 3 uniform hypergraph? This is for a graph. So this is k equals 2. How about k equals 3? Well, let's try and do the same thing. Let's order the vertices by their degrees. Let's go on from the left until we find a vertex V1 that's in I. Throw out everybody here. But what else can we throw out? Well, nothing, right? All we know is that there's a bunch of pairs which together with VI form a triple. Right? There's a whole bunch. So you get some kind of graph. Okay, but we're going to want to remember what this graph is. So starting with an H3, a 3 uniform hypergraph, we're going to perform this algorithm and construct a two-uniform hypergraph, which is consists of these edges. I should make draw them red, right? Because they're now forbidden. Then, once we have this two-uniform hypergraph, we're going to do the whole thing again and get a one-uniform hypergraph. Okay, well, the one-uniform hypergraph was just what we did here, right? The one-uniform hypergraph of vertices, which are definitely not in our set. Right? So this is the idea, that we're going to order the vertices by their degrees, look from left to right until we find a vertex that's in I. That vertex goes in S, and then we obtain, we get to throw out some vertices, fine, but more importantly, well, okay, no. This is going to be very important as well. But we also get this forbidden two-uniform hypergraph, which we can then run the same process on afterwards. So you mean you might find that this one is in, and then you get to throw out this one, or what?
No, I mean that. So now that you look at H2,
yep.
The substructure, and possibly all of these forbidden edges have low degree, so they are far to the right in your picture. So it could just be, well, in that case, maybe it doesn't really matter, but it could be better just to continue looking from V1 and continue.
So yeah. The algorithm that I'm going to outline doesn't work in general. We're going to need to do things like control the number of edges in H2 and the degrees of the vertices in H2 as well. So no, we're only going to use supersaturation. So we're actually going to do this several times. So this process, we're going to iterate many times. And each iteration, we're going to apply at the start the supersaturation. But in the middle of this process, we're not going to use it. So I'm actually going to first prove a sort of key lemma, which doesn't use supersaturation at all, which allows you to go from H3 to take sort of one step towards finding this F. So maybe I'll try and state a lemma like that. Right. Yeah, so yes, so you're right. It's not quite what we did before. We're going to say H3 has many edges by supersaturation. Then that implies that, well, either H2 has many edges or we've thrown away a lot of vertices. If we've thrown a lot of vertices, we're happy. If we haven't, then H2 has lots of edges, and so we run the process there. Yeah. Yeah, so you're right. It's a bit. I cheated a bit by. Yeah, the introduction was. I mean, it definitely does vastly oversimplify, which is why. I mean, this was discovered sort of in the early 80s, and this was only discovered fairly recently. Yeah. Okay, so let's try to state a key lemma. So let's let H3 be a three-uniform hypergraph. And I'm definitely going to need it later, though I don't necessarily need it now. But I'm always going to allow my hypergraph to have multiple edges. Okay. So an edge can appear more than once in a hypergraph, and we just allow that, and we don't identify them. You can have five edges that are the same. Okay. This will simplify things somewhat, and also it will be useful in applications. Sorry?
So three uniform sets is?
All edges have size three. But I'm about to give conditions. So maybe I'll just call it H for now. So I need to tell you what this means. So perhaps I'll do that over here somewhere. So the degree in a hypergraph H of a set T is equal to the number of edges that contain T. Okay? That's just what you might expect the degree of a set is. And note that here, this is a multi-set. If they're multi-edges, you count them with multiplicity. Okay. And the degree, d L of H for any L is the maximum degree in H of T, such that the size of T is L. Okay. This is the max degree of an L set in the hypergraph. So this is for L between 1 and K. So when L equals K is just the maximum number of times a particular edge appears. And I'm going to want, this is at most some constant. This could be a large constant. Times P to the L minus 1 times E of H over V of H. For each L between 1 and K. So K is 3, thank you. Ah, I haven't told you what P is yet. So we're gonna have a delta that's fixed as well. So maybe I'll tell you afterwards what all these things are. Then there exist functions G mapping I to S, F, mapping S just to subsets of the vertices of H, such that size of S is at most C times P times the number of vertices in H for all S in S, and the size of F of S is at most 1 minus delta times V of H. Okay, so maybe V of H has N vertices. It's the same, no, yes, that's a little C. So what am I saying? So for all delta little c, p, I mean this? No, there exists a big C. Are my big C's and little c's obviously different or not? Okay, this is a slightly technical statement. So let me try and explain what's going on. Yes. Yeah. Some P. Yeah, so the stronger the bound on your maximum degrees, the stronger the bound on the size of the set S, right? And we want our sets S, these are these G of I's, this fingerprint, to be as small as possible. Okay, so we'll pick P to be as small as possible subject to these inequalities. Right? And what do we get? There's no mention of F here, right? There's no curly family F. We just find a set F of S that's a little bit smaller than the whole thing. Right? So we're just going to try and throw away some tiny proportion of the vertices in the first step. Okay, so this is a single step of the process. We're going to iterate this lots and lots of times. And every time we're going to throw away a delta proportion of the vertices, and eventually we're going to end up with some very small set. Okay? And we can do this as long as these conditions are satisfied. Right? So we can do this as long as our P doesn't blow up. Right? As long as our hypergraph basically has lots of edges, and these edges are reasonably uniformly distributed, then we can find a little tiny set, S, that allows us to shrink our universe a little bit, and then our universe becomes slightly smaller. And if on that universe, we still have lots of edges which are uniformly distributed, then everything's okay. If on that universe we have few edges, well, we should be happy by our supersaturation theorem. If we have badly distributed edges, we're stuffed. So we have to make sure we don't have badly distributed edges. Okay? So our algorithm is going to enforce this condition. Okay? We're going to make sure this is true for the P we want always. And then we're going to hope we have enough edges. If we don't have enough edges, that's fine, because we're now not in F anymore. Okay? Yeah, so perhaps before proving this key lemma, I should use it to prove the theorem. I think that's better, because otherwise it seems just like magic and unmotivated. So maybe I'll even actually, given that I'm now working in... So the difficult part is proving the lemma. Deducing the theorem is relatively easy. So let's do it for K uniform. Right, everything else is the same. Okay. So if we can prove this for a K uniform hypergraph, which we will do, maybe next week, then we can prove this theorem for all k. Okay? Okay, so how do we do that? So, key lemma implies theorem 2. Well, so extra ingredient that we need is Semiradi's theorem. Okay. This is a generalization of Semiradi's theorem, so we'd be lucky if we could get away without using it. So I'm going to write the supersaturation version. Which is, which we proved last week. So this is the following. For every positive delta, if n is sufficiently large, and A is a subset of prompt n of size delta n, then A contains, see, many, so Semiradis' theorem, the original version, tells you you have at least one k-term arithmetic progression. Right? You happy with Semiradis' theorem or no? Okay. This is Semiradis' original theorem. That any subset of the integers of positive density contains a k-term arithmetic progression. And a very simple averaging argument allows you to get a stronger result. Yep. No. No. Yeah, so that works, yeah, without the supersaturation. But the application needs supersaturation. Yeah. So, sorry, you don't. So the supersaturation version says you don't just contain one of them; you contain many. What is many? A positive proportion of all of them. Right. How many k-term arithmetic progressions are there? Roughly n squared, because you pick the first element, you pick the common difference. And that determines the AP. Right? Okay. So, okay. So, what are these conditions for the original hypergraph? So let H encode k-term APs in 1 to n. What is delta L of H? Well, it depends on what L is. So what is delta 1 of H? At most. So this is just a test of definitions. Yeah, it's the maximum of KAPs that a single element is a member of. We just said you pick an element and a common difference, then you get. So what's a way of counting that? Well, let's pick which element it is, and then let's pick the common difference. Okay. So it's at most k times n. So it's probably even less than that, right? It's probably only, so the common difference has to be less than n over k, so it's at most n. Okay? What is lambda 2 of h? Yeah, once you know which two indices they are, then you know what it is. Right. So it's at most k choose 2. And OK, that's true for all the rest of them. Yeah, I guess delta k is 1, so might as well note that as well. Why not? Okay? Okay. So what value of p do we want to, can we apply in the first step? Ah, so we also want to know E of H and, F and V of H are. Well, E of H is the number of K-term APs. So it's roughly n squared. And V of H is the number of vertices, so it's equals n. So sorry?
The number of edges,
Yeah, so k is a constant, and I mean this up to a constant, but yeah, if we want to count carefully, pick your first element, you have n choices, pick the common difference, you have roughly n over k choices. Okay, so it's at least n over 2 times n over k, so it's at least. It's at least that, and it's at most that times 2. Is that right? I think that's right. Right, your common difference has to be at most n over k, so that gives the upper bound. And if you pick an element in the first half, and your common difference is at most n over 2k, then you're definitely OK. Right? Is it OK? Is it OK? So you want to pick the first element and the common difference. And you have at most n choices for the first element, and the most n over k choices for the common difference. That gives this. And for a lower bound, pick the first element in the first half, and pick the common difference at most n over 2k, and you definitely don't fall off the end. Okay, so what do we want p to be? So we need. Well, n to be at most c times e of h over v of h. That's okay. If c is bigger than k, 4k or something. That's the case, l equals 1. We need k choose 2. To be at most c times p to the l minus 1 times this guy, which is basically n. And this implies that p is at least n to the minus 1 over k minus 1, right? So this is for 2 between l. And k. Yeah, I'll work to k. I say need, but really I mean it suffices. Okay. So if p is, let's say, much bigger than this, we can say it'd be equal to this. Yeah, because we take c bigger. So if p is bigger than n to the minus 1 over k minus 1, then these conditions are satisfied for the original hypergraph. Right? And moreover, while we're about it, if we look at, so after a few steps of this process, we'll be looking at some subset of the vertices, right? As long as that subset of the vertices has a positive proportion of all edges, and if c, little c is sufficiently large, then this they still hold. Right? For the same p. Right? If E of H is bigger than epsilon times the original number, is bigger than epsilon n squared, which is what this is going to give us, then this is still going to hold, but with some c that depends on epsilon, okay? Which it can. Is this okay? No? Well, then why didn't you ask? Oh, okay. So now you're asking. okay. So let me just repeat this argument, but assuming we're on some subset. Is it clear why we're going to be on a subset or not? Or should I do a step of the argument first? Let's do the first step of the argument, and then we'll come back and repeat it.
The problem is that there's some limitation
that I
keep forgetting what f is and what s is.
There's no f and... Oh, sorry, there is an f now.
Yes,
yeah. Should I draw the picture again? H, I, I'm going to find a little set G of I, and a big set F of G of I. So the little set is going to encode the independent set, and the I is going to be contained in F of G of I. Did I not put that in the conditions? Probably I want that in the conditions. Sorry? Thank you, yes. Very good point. Sorry, yes. This matches that P. Yeah. Yeah. The choice of P is supposed to be suggestive. It's the P which we'll be able to apply the result for. In the random result. Yeah. And sorry, I forgot in this statement, annoyingly, I'm gonna erase the word function so I can fit it in. The crucial thing that G of I is contained in I, which is contained in G of I union F of G of I. Yeah, so I understand that the statement is not very intuitive. So it's why I'm trying to do everything sort of five times, so it becomes gradually more and more intuitive. So this F in the key lemma is only slightly smaller than the original vertex set. Right. So this at the moment is actually the vertex set of H, which is for us 1 up to n. So that's what the big thing is. Okay, so let's set P equal to this. Okay? So we're just going to, for the rest of this proof, we're just going to fix P equals n to the minus 1 over k minus 1, and I claim that the condition is satisfied. And not just for the original hypergraph, but for any on any subset of size at least delta n. So maybe I'll state that as a as an observation. If A is a subset of n, size of A is at least delta n, then delta L of H restricted to A is at most C P to the L minus 1 E of H restricted to A over V of H restricted to A, where P equals N to the minus 1 over K minus 1 and C equals, I don't know. There's an epsilon somewhere, right? Yeah, I don't know. K squared over epsilon or something. Sorry, in this theorem here. So this is the delta, the same delta and the same epsilon. Yeah. So proof by Semiradis theorem, supersaturation version, E of H of A is at least epsilon times n squared over 4k. Right? Oh no, I even said n squared, so it makes life even easier. Sorry. Epsilon n squared. Okay. Let's see. I'm going to try a 1. We'll see. Okay. And V of H of A is certainly at most N, because A is a subset of 1 to N. And P is this. Right? So, let's have to know that delta 1 of H of A is, well, it's at most delta 1 of h, right? So it's still at most n. And that's equal to c times this guy over this guy. Right? Is that okay? I'm going to write the other one in the same place. So tell me before I write over this. Is it okay? This is just the bound of delta 1 of h that we wrote down here. And this is just the fact that c equals 1 over epsilon. And this is e of ha over v of ha. These are the bounds we have on them. Right? And if we take L at least 2, well, this is at most K choose 2. And this is supposed to be at most C times P to the K minus 1 times these same things. And it is, because P to the K minus 1 equals 1 over N. Right? So, I did need K squared. Well, I don't actually need k squared, because this is only sharp when L equals k, and then the bound is 1. But whatever. Yeah. Is that OK? So now we have this and this, where this epsilon is the one in the supersaturation theorem. Okay. Okay, so now we're basically done. Because all we have to do is apply the key lemma a large but bounded number of times, and we'll end up with what we want, with the counting that we want. Okay? So.
Apply key lemma.
How many times? I have two different deltas, but they can both be small, right? So say one over delta squared times. Okay. What does that mean? That we apply it to H, we obtain functions which map our independent sets into these small sets, and we get some f, and then we apply it to f of s. So what do I mean? So given I in I of h, say m, why not? Key lemma gives, let's say, call it g0 of I and f0 of g0 of I. Let's call these things S1 and, oh, let's just call them G, whatever, and A1, okay, which have the properties there. Now we apply it to H restricted to A1. Right. Yes. Exactly. Exactly. So either A1 is bigger than delta times n, which implies that E of H, well, so by the observation, this implies that the conditions of the key lemma are satisfied. This is by the observation. Or A1 is smaller than delta n, in which case we stop. Right?
Question?
Yep.
So then you throw away everything which is outside A1.
Yes. Sorry?
Why are you left
with that? Ah. Because of this condition, this key condition, which I didn't write down the first time. So I apologize for that.
Yeah, so I contained that, but
ah, yes. Sorry. So we're going to apply it, given an I, we're going to apply the key lemma this many times. We're going to do this for every I. Okay? So what do we have to do? We have to, given an I, we have to construct.
You're counting independent sets, right?
Yeah.
So, but if you're going to repeat the procedure for each I, that seems like you have to know how many sets there are.
We're going to do it for all of them. We're going to find, we're going to basically construct a G and an F where, which have similar properties except, yeah, so perhaps I was hoping not to have to state the slightly more technical theorem, but basically we're going to make these things small. So let me state the actual theorem we're proving. Maybe that's better. So, theorem is that there exists a collection, let's call it C, of sets of subsets of at most n, choose delta n. Do I mean this? No, I mean even better than that. C times p times n for some large constant, where p is this guy here. Subsets of, well, it's n, such that every independent set is contained, i.e. KAP free set. Is contained in some C in C. So this is why they're called containers, because we're going to find this collection C of containers for the independent sets. Right. And the important thing about this is there's not very many of them. And the size of C is at most delta n for all C and C. They're also small. Okay. So there's fewer of them, and they're also small. So this is what we're trying to do. So for each independent set, we're going to try and construct one of these containers. Okay. So given the independent set, we're going to go through and we're going to try and throw away some vertices which are definitely not in the independent set. But we're going to try and do it in such a way that there aren't too many of them. So we're going to do that by only throwing away things depending on some very small subset. Right? So remember, given this I, we're going to try and throw away a few vertices. But to decide which one to throw away, we're only going to look at some tiny set G of I. Okay? And because we only looked at this set G of I, in order to throw these vertices away, there aren't going to be too many choices. Right, because this is the number of choices for G of I. G of I is small, it only has size C times P times N. That was here. And therefore, there's only this many choices. Right. And this container theorem, well, immediately implies theorem two. It's now 5, so possibly I failed to prove this in this time.
Is delta n comes from delta n choose n?
Yes. Yeah, so sorry, I could have put it inside. Maybe it makes more sense that way. Yeah, so it's the same thing, of course. Sorry? Not if n is large. Yes, but it gets absorbed in. Yeah. So the main thing. Yeah. So the point is, this thing is much smaller than delta n choose m if M is bigger than this.
Right.
Yeah, these are not the same C's again. Every time the C, you go forward one theorem, your C gets a bit bigger. Yeah, while your universe gets a bit smaller. Okay. So it's almost a proof. I mean, I hope you almost believe that this works, right? You just continue applying the lemma. Every time you get to some set A of remaining vertices, either you're big, your condition's satisfied, and you can take one extra step, or you're small, in which you stop, and your A becomes one of these containers. Right? When you stop, that's your container. And by definition, it's small. Okay. And the point is, you only ran through a bounded number of iterations of the key lemma. And each time, you acquired another set G of I. Okay. So you're getting a large constant number of these things. But each time, they're small. So add them all up. You still only get a small number of subsets. Okay. Right. You're gonna apply the lemma a bounded number of times. Each time you apply it, you acquire another little set inside I. So you have a bounded number of these little sets. Each one has size constant times p times n. So the total number of choices is n choose constant times p times n, okay, to a constant, but that just means you can change this constant, whatever. Yes. Yeah, yeah. This is counting them.
Yeah, but going from there to that delta n of choose n.
That's trivial, as long as you allow me to take a different delta. So if I put two delta here, it makes it more obvious, right? Because then, so what's the size of IHM? Size of IHM is at most the sum over containers of the size of the container choose M, right? Everyone's contained in a container, so this is clear. And this is at most number of choices N choose C P N times delta n choose m, and this is at most 2 delta n choose m, because m is much bigger than p times n. Right. So we use this condition, this very last step. The numerator is basically the same, n and delta n, doesn't make much difference. The denominator, this is c times n to the 1 minus, it's the same bound, right? So we need a bigger constant than this one. So how are we going to write root c or something? Right. Sorry, all of my c's are different. But if m is much bigger than a bigger constant than this one, then this term dominates. Yeah, if you're not convinced, then you just have to write out what the normal approximation and it's easy. But okay. Yeah, so okay, next time I'll start with a recap of the key lemma and how it implies this theorem. Yeah, I'll try and find a slightly different way to explain it. Yeah, and then the main job is to prove the key lemma. That's the main task. Okay.